growing and nurtured.
Growing and nurtured.
Developing and loved.
Developing and loved.
I was God's delight day by day.
I was God's delight day by day.
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 I was delight of the world.
I was delight of the world.
Playing and dancing.
Playing and dancing.
Dancing and delighting.
Dancing and delighting.
Playing in God's wondrous world.
Playing in God's wondrous world.
In God's world of wonders.
In God's world of wonders.
Delighting in Adam's offspring.
Delighting in Adam's offspring.
Playing with the children of Adam and Eve.
Playing with the children of Adam and Eve.
Let us play.
Let us play.
Amen.
Amen.
Sit down. And with that, I want to kind of do an audiovisual meditation of this psalm, of this Proverbs passage as well. So just sit back and relax. Thank you. to the spirit, get into the spirit of Proverbs. The play, the wonder, the joy of children exploring the world, captured by wisdom's own joy, having been given birth by God, growing up beside God, and reveling in the wonder of the world. And so for me, part of the power of this passage is its moral component as well. And that is that it is our obligation as adults to ensure that the world is safe for children, and that the world we leave for our children and for their children has to be secure and safe and wondrous. Are we doing that? I do wonder if our children and their children will look back at us and condemn us for what we've done to this creation. Their lives are going to be harder than ours. There's just no doubt about that. But whatever we can do to mitigate the damage already done will bear fruit in the generations to come. And that's what gives me hope. But right now, just the love and play and joy of children and the wonder they exude as a lesson for us as grown-ups, presumably responsible. Yeah, but may we never lack or lose that sense of wonder of the world. I'm sure some of you have heard of Rachel Carson, the author of Silent Spring. When she wrote that book, she received a lot of flack, even within the scientific community, not to mention, of course, from pesticide industries. But after that book, she wrote a little book called A Sense of Wonder. And it actually started as a magazine article, I think in Harper's Magazine, but it has been turned into sort of a coffee table photography book. But it's all about her time walking in the woods with her 5-year-old nephew and relearning what wonder is about, seeing the world through his eyes. I recommend that book. Yeah. Well, welcome to Wisdom's Wonder. And we're going to take a little bit of a break as I switch to another PowerPoint presentation on the book of Job, also within the wisdom literature. But we move from wisdom's wonder to wounded wonder in the book of Job. So stand up for a moment, stretch, and we'll reconvene in a moment. I'll be doing something that interests you, or you'd be gone by now, so thank you for coming back. So we move from Proverbs and that sense of joy and wonder about the world seen through the eyes of woman wisdom as a child. Now we go to Job, who is the patriarch of his community, upstanding, upright, man of great wealth, who also experiences a radically transformative experience of wonder towards the end of the book. And what I also want to do, more than just recounting the narrative of Job as it leads to the last few chapters, is also bring in an emerging scientific discipline called astrobiology, which I mentioned a little bit last night. Astrobiology studies the possibility of life beyond planet Earth, and what life might look like, how we can detect life outside of our planet, and to think through the implications of that societally, and for me, to think through it theologically as well. And I hinted at, if there is life out there beyond planet Earth, what does that say about, say, in the book of Genesis? We would have to admit that God is at work in performing a genesis of life beyond what we're aware of. And so what does that mean as we read about Genesis in the book of Genesis? Is it not just the life that we're aware of, but perhaps life that is beyond our imagination, that is taking place, unfolding, evolving, developing in another galaxy or in a solar system within our own galaxy as well? So I'm going to bring all that together in Job, which I think Here's my argument. Job is the most astrobiologically friendly book in the Bible. And I'll show you why in a moment. But first, I call it, so we have the temple of life in Genesis 1. And now we have what I call the tempest of life in the book of Job. But first, a little bit about the history of science as it's leading up to astrobiology. So science has undergone a series of revolutions. First one being the Copernican Revolution demonstrated that Earth is not the center of the universe, let alone the center of our solar system. The Sun is. We're simply one of several planets orbiting the Sun, our home star. And so, yeah, in the 15th to 16th century, actually, Copernicus' work was published, I think, the year after his death. His own proof that the Earth is just another planet orbiting the Sun, not the center of really anything, except within our own eyes. So the Copernican Revolution was a paradigmatic shift in the history of science. It wasn't an unprecedented theory, however. A Greek philosopher by the name of Aristarchus had actually proffered that theory that the Sun was the center of a system, but it was forgotten. And then Copernicus picked it up, and then was also supported later by Galileo. So the Copernican Revolution, the Darwinian Revolution, more recently in our lifetime, Charles Darwin published a groundbreaking work in 1859, The Origin of Species, in which he demonstrated that that life was dynamically evolving through the process of natural selection, and with that was an awareness that we were all interconnected, what later would be discovered genetically as the DNA, the code of life, that we share this genetic code with all life as we know it on this planet. So we're not the singular species that we thought we were. We are linked with the rest of life. And it gives sort of a nice, shall I say, revision of Rene Descartes' slogan, I think, therefore I am. With biological evolution now that we are so familiar with, that has to be revised to, I link, therefore I am. And you know, there's a Presbyterian version of that as well, right? I think, therefore I am. Gratitude is what makes us what we are. Yeah, so the Copernican Revolution and the Darwinian Revolution. And tomorrow morning in Sunday school, I'm going to talk about how Darwin's theory of evolution actually impacted the life of Columbia Theological Seminary in the late 19th century. So hold on for that. Anyway, now another revolution as well, more recent, is what I call the Shapley-Hubble Revolution. I talked about Edwin Hubble last night a little bit, who discovered that the Milky Way is not the only galaxy in town. There are other galaxies, and that these galaxies are rushing away at an accelerated rate from each other. So he discovered the existence of other galaxies. So through his 100-inch telescope on Palomar. And so with that, though, is Harlow Shapley, who was able to determine that the Milky Way, our own galaxy, is much larger than we ever thought until then. An interesting relationship between Hubble and Shapley was that Harlow Shapley was very suspicious of Edwin Hubble's research, and he thought it was just junk science. And so one day, he received a letter from Edwin Hubble, which showed irrefutable data that there was other galaxies. And so he showed this letter, Harlow Shapley showed this letter to his associate and said, this is the letter that has destroyed my universe. And ever since then, he was very supportive of Edwin Hubble. So I bring them together as the Shapley-Hubble Revolution about interstellar, intergalactic dimensions of the universe. And so this is our latest deep photograph of space. No, not that one. Sorry. Well, anyway, there it is. That's what I was looking for. So this comes from the Hubble Space Telescope, which is in its last phases of life. James Webb Telescope was to be launched this year, but due to mechanical reasons, has been postponed for several years from now. But once that is launched and in operation, we'll be able to discover many more exoplanets. The Hubble Space Telescope is still working and has generated so many revelatory images of the universe. And this one was taken at a particular, from the naked eye, from our perspective, a particularly dark part of the night sky. And look how it's filled with this. How many stars do you think are in this photograph?
A lot.
There are only two stars. There's one. There's one. And the rest are galaxies. Each galaxy has at least 200 billion stars. And you know how many galaxies are in the universe, what the latest count is, the latest estimation? Over a trillion. A trillion galaxies, each one with at least 200 billion stars. And then there's our Milky Way, in which we are. We orbit a particular star, and it's come to our realization that each star likely has a planetary system. So how many planets are in the universe? This boggles the mind. Do you think there's life out there?
Yes.
It seems statistically very probable, given all the worlds that are out there. Will we ever come in contact with life beyond our solar system? That depends on who is trying to contact us, I think. The distance and the time factor are both mitigating factors against the possibility that we will ever have contact with alien life. And yet, even with the absence of contact, even though there are measures, you know, there's the SETI program, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, in which there are radio telescopes pointed in various regions of the sky trying to detect any kind of radio signal. Hasn't happened yet, despite one incident, I think back in the 70s, where it was thought, oh my gosh, we've received something, but it's never been repeated. But in any case, we may never receive a signal. And we're sending signals out too, of course. I don't have any hope within my lifetime that we'll be contacted by aliens, despite the great movie Contact with Jodie Foster. But it is likely, I think, that life is out there, far, far away. Although the closest planetary system is about 4.4 light years away. And we have discovered in that in that solar system, there is at least one rocky planet that resembles Earth. The first rule of thumb in astrobiology is that you follow the water. The water has to be liquid. And actually, there are two celestial bodies within our solar system that have liquid flowing water. Actually, three now. Mars seems to have some kind of seasonal variation of watery movement. It's very salty, briny water. But it's water. But perhaps more promising are two moons. One of Saturn and one of Jupiter, Enceladus and Europa, in which in our flyby missions we discovered spouts of water, geysers of water erupting from the icy crust of these moons, which says that underneath the ice there is flowing liquid water. And as one astrobiologist once said, if I had all the money in the world, I would shoot myself up to Europa and go ice fishing. Who knows what you might find underneath the surface. But if there is, even if it's monocellular life, you know, just single cellular life underneath the icy surface, that would prove that the universe is seeded with life. even in those extreme conditions within our solar system, whether it's Mars, and it may be that we'll discover that there was once life on Mars, if there is no life anymore, but maybe continuing life on Enceladus and Europa. Life, even in those extreme conditions, who knows what's out there? How does that make you feel? Sick to your stomach? The famous biologist who sort of writes theologically, Ursula Goodenough, she wrote a wonderful book called The Sacred Depths of Nature. And she recounts one time when she was camping in Colorado, and she was a student in college, and she was taking a class on astrophysics. And she was lying on her back, looking up at the bright stars in the darkest night, away from steady lights, and she was suddenly gripped by a sense of terror over the very immensity of the universe that was right there before her eyes. And you know that in deep space, there is also deep time. So when you look up into the night sky, you're actually looking back in time. You know, we have time travel machines. They're called telescopes. So the realization of all of that immensity just crushed her. And it took her a while to move from that sense of terror to a sense of wonder. Sometimes wonder can start with a sense of fear. So perhaps it's appropriate that we do look out there, and when we think about it long enough, and as we keep our eyes glued to what's out there, it's appropriate that we are first gripped with a sense of fear. Maybe it's a fear over the sense of smallness, of how small we are, you and I, how small our planet is. Carl Sagan called it the pale blue dot, and for good reason. And there's so much more out there. It's the fear of being decentered. Like these other previous scientific revolutions, we're not the center of the universe, we're not the center of the system of planets, and we're certainly not the center of the vast array that's out there. And we're not the center of life on this planet either. We are linked to life. We're simply one species among many other species. And you know, we're continuing to discover species on this planet. Some of them are labeled extremophiles, because they live in very harsh conditions, like under the Arctic ice or in deep thermal vents at the bottom of the ocean. Some forms of life feed on acid. That's here on our planet. And so that makes us sort of a soft, vulnerable creature compared to these hardy extremophiles that can live in such extreme conditions. And clearly, if we find life elsewhere in our solar system, they would be extremophiles, because those planets beyond Earth are extreme planets from our perspective, but it's from our perspective. Yeah, so there we go. The size of this photograph is just no bigger than the top half of my fingernail stretched out from an arm's length. Just jam-packed with galaxies. So, to review, the Copernican Revolution was a revolution concerning our spatial orientation with respect to the sun. The sun does not orbit the Earth. We orbit the sun. And a revolution about life on this planet, that we are linked to all of life, and it has undergone evolution to the point that we have emerged as the most complex beings of life, and yet remaining linked to the rest of life. And the Hubblean-Chaplin revolution, we moved from Copernican solar space, if you will, to intergalactic space. The question is now, are we in store for another revolution? We moved from space to life, to space to life in space, maybe. And some of the NASA scientists I've talked to say within 10 to 15 years from now, we will discover life within our solar system. That's the confidence they have. Of course, they have to be confident to receive money. So they're not going to waver in their confidence because they want to do this, whether it proves successful or not. So space, life in space. It's kind of a nice, nice continuum of revolutions. So one can only imagine. For me, one can only hope. Are we alone in the universe? That is sort of an existential, if not a theological question. And yet we have to remind ourselves, we're not alone in the universe, because we're not alone on this planet. This planet is filled with life. Even as 1,000 species go extinct every year, we're discovering more species that thrive in extreme conditions. So I love this quote from J.B.S. Haldane, a great evolutionary biologist, who once said, "Now, my own suspicion is that the universe is not only queerer than we suppose, but queerer than we can suppose." That is, the universe is a very strange place. Different kinds of stars, different kinds of planets, maybe even different kinds of life out there. Life that we might not be able to detect. Maybe we need to, in order to detect strange life, alien life, we need to redefine what life is. So a lot of philosophers and scientists are pondering those questions. But in any case, it's a strange world that we live in. And then there's Paul Wallace, a good friend of mine who teaches astrophysics at Agnes Scott College, just down the road from Columbia Seminary. We've actually co-taught a class on theology and science. There's no scientific project more obviously religious than the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. There's sort of a religious motivation behind this quest. Again, to answer the question, are we alone out there in the universe? That's a deep, personal, profound question of the human condition to ask. And his point is that it has religious overtones as well. So the scope of astrobiology is that it looks at the big picture, the universe, but it also looks at the smallest picture as well, the origin of life, from organic material to monocellular life, that jump between organic to organism. And if there's anything that begins to reproduce itself, to self-replicate, that's the beginning of life. We haven't gotten there yet, but maybe in 10 to 15 years we'll be able to shrink that gap scientifically. So with that in mind, sort of this astrobiological perspective, how do I read scripture as a result? And so this image of the cosmic Torah I like, and it helps me realize that the scope of the biblical message is actually cosmic in many ways. Genesis 1 is cosmic. The new creation in the book of Revelation is cosmic in scope. Psalm 8, you know, when I look upon the stars up into the heavens, and I ask the question, how are you mindful of us, O God? What is it that makes you mindful of me? That question from the 8th Psalm. When I gaze upon the work of your fingers, who am I? That's the question that was asked in ancient times, just from somebody looking up into the night sky without even the aid of binoculars, let alone a telescope, but still sensing the immensity of the universe, and then sensing one's own smallness vis-a-vis the vastness of the universe. So the question persists, I think. We know much more about the universe than the psalmist ever knew, about its size, about its age, about the trillion galaxies that are out there. Do you think from our science that question of who am I is rendered obsolete? Now, I think it's pressed with even greater urgency as we realize how much bigger the universe is than the psalmist could ever imagine. And the statement of faith, the claim of faith, is that we are cared for by God. Psalm 147, God counts the stars and names them. how many stars would they be? But you know what? God knows our names as well. And perhaps that's the most wondrous thing of all. So, to Job. Job is a, let's just say Job suffers. Two waves of disasters, having lost his children and then being diseased with boils on his skin. I think you can kind of pick out who he is in this portrayal by William Blake. You see Job? Yeah. So who's this woman right here?
His wife.
His wife. What is her name? She doesn't have a name in the book of Job. There is a rewriting of the book of Job called the Testament of Job, which is a pseudepigraphical work that was written sometime around the time of Jesus. And she's given a name. Her name is Sidus. And who are these fellows here? These three friends. Yeah. You know who the shortest person in the Bible is? Bildad the Shuhite. That's him right there. There's Eliphaz and Zophar. And there's actually somebody else who shows up a little later. His name is Elihu. But we're not going to mention him. He just kind of inserts himself into the discussion as a young whippersnapper. But here are his three friends. And you know the first thing they do when they see Job? They sit with him in silence for 7 days and seven nights. That's the best thing they did for Job. Because thereafter, they engage in dialogue with him. And the only way they can make sense of Job's suffering is that he must have committed some egregious sin in his former life. Now he's paying for it. And that raises Job's ire against his friends because now he's forced to defend himself in the midst of his own suffering. He sought sympathy and compassion from his friends. In fact, it's said in the narration, the friends came to comfort and to console him. But they did little of that. After they broke the silence, they accused him. In a way, with their insults and their accusations, they end up crucifying him. So, and Job is never really patient because he gets very angry against his friends and he gets very angry at God. He thinks God has committed a travesty of justice. He knows he's innocent. So anything that he has done in his previous life does not warrant the extent of his suffering. And so he knows he's innocent. So his only conclusion is that God has made a mistake. God has targeted him and oppressed him, has shot him full of the arrows of the Almighty, those are some of his words, for no reason, without any rationale. And so Job demands an accounting from God, so much so that Job sort of rises up out of his ash heap to call God to court. During the last speeches of Job's discourse is that he's basically issuing a subpoena against God. He wants God to come to court and to explain God's self before him. He wants answers. God doesn't show up in court, but God does show up. So the question is, how does Job get from this bitter lament of despair to being captivated by a sense of wonder at the end after God does show up? And so Job's penultimate words are, I spoke of things I did not understand, things too wonderful for me to know. This is a testimony of wonder. And it is his response. It is his response to after God has shown up as a whirlwind, a voice in the whirlwind, to show him a few things about the world. So there's another depiction by William Blake. So let's kind of explore what God says. What has Job beheld to move him from woundedness to wonder? You know, there is a tie between wonder and wound. There are certain etymologists who suggest that the word wonder actually is related to the word wound. And it comes from the German, Wunde and Wunder. I am not a linguist to judge one way or the other, but if there's any Bible book that expresses the relationship between wound and wonder, it's the book of Job. It is out of his woundedness that he comes to a radical experience of wonder. So what happens there? So God says, finally shows up, and God says out of the whirlwind, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me." And then God goes through this litany of creation, asking Job, "Were you there when I did this? Have you seen how I did that?" So, beginning in verse 4, "Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? On what were its bases sunk, or who laid its cornerstone?" And it sounds like the God of Proverbs who is constructing all these things. And then at the end, "When the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy." And this begins Job's journey through the power of divine poetry. This begins Job's journey into the cosmos. And God shows Job things that are unimaginable and beyond the perception of any human being. The gates of death in the depths, the dwelling place of light, the storehouses of hail and ice, the extremities of the earth into the wilderness beyond human control. All that is laid before Job through this recitation of poetry that God recites. And so it's through the imagination that Job then encounters these wonders of the creation, of the created order, beyond himself, beyond his world, beyond the land and sea. It's as if his ash heap turned into a magic carpet, and he sees a whole new world, and it's an astounding world of height and depth and extreme. And one of my favorite passages has something to do with the desert. "Who has cut a channel for the downpours and a way for the thunderbolts, to bring rain upon a no man's land, upon an uninhabitable desert, to satisfy the desolate wasteland, and to bring forth grass growth?" So the desert, a no man's land, beyond Job's purview. And God is saying, if you think when you look out there that it's all just a wasteland, look again. I am there renewing life in the desert. I am channeling the waters to give new life to the desert, to satisfy the desolate wasteland, and to bring forth grass growth. It may be uninhabitable in your eyes, but in my eyes, it is full of life. And I can appreciate that because, you know, my ethnic identity is desert rat. I grew up in the Southwest desert. And so I love the desert, and I know how full of life it is, and how dangerous it is, too. Anybody recognize this background photograph? Have you ever been there? Where is it? Ghost Ranch. Yeah, one of my favorite places on Earth. Yeah. In fact, I'm leading a session at Ghost Ranch the first week in April. I think there's a waiting list now, but sign up if you can. I'd love to see you there. Yeah, and then this poetry, I think, begets poetry. I think one of the powerful aspects of biblical poetry that it invites you to continue writing poetry. And so I've done a little bit of that myself, astrobiologically, and here's what I've written. "Who has made the comet's gaseous tail and cut away for the watery plumes of Enceladus to provide an icy ring for Saturn? Who brings the rains of liquid methane to fill Titan's lakes and deltas? Who keeps Europa's oceans warm, swaddled under its icy surface, preserving the threshold of life?" Never going to be published, but you've seen it. This is actually a kind of poetry and hope that there is something living on these celestial bodies in our solar system. Yeah. So the poetry of God is revelatory for Job to show him that there is life out there beyond his imagination. And then with that, the conclusion of God's poetry lists several wild animals. Part of what I would call God's wild kingdom, which includes the lion, the raven, the mountain goat, the deer, the onager or the wild ass, the auroch or the wild ox, and there's the ostrich and the warhorse and the hawk, the vulture, and then the two mythological creatures, the behemoth and leviathan. And I want to read to you some of the descriptions that God gives to Job about these creatures. So let's start with the lion. The lion is the first creature that God likes to talk about. Can you hunt the prey for the lion, or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their covert? That question, can you hunt the prey for the lion, is not the question that Job would have expected. The question Job would have expected would be, can you kill the lion? Just like any good king in the ancient Near East, to prove his military prowess, a king would go out and hunt lions. A good lion is a dead lion. The king of the world, the emperor of the world, has to kill the king of beasts, the king of the jungle, the king of the wilderness, the lion, like Ashurbanipal, this Assyrian emperor. So, yeah, those are what lions were, objects for target practice. But not so in God's eyes. God asks Job, not can you kill the lion, but can you provide for the lion? That begins to turn Job's world upside down. It's all about the provision of life beyond one's own human imagination. And then there's the mountain goat. Do you know when the mountain goats give birth? Do you observe the calving of the deer? Can you number the months that they fulfill? And do you know the time when they give birth, when they crouch to give birth to their offspring and are delivered of their young? Their young ones become strong. They grow up in the open. They go forth and do not return. So instead of death and chaos, God shows Job vitality. In places that are wild, they are no man's lands, and yet life is given birth, and vitality develops as we move from one generation to the next. And then there's the wild ass, or the onager. Who has let the wild ass go free? Who has loosed the bonds of the swift ass, to which I have given the steppe for its home, and the salt land for its dwelling place? It scorns the tumult of the city. It does not hear the shouts of the driver. It ranges the mountains as its pasture, and it searches after every green thing. So the onager is no beast of burden. This is a quintessentially wild creature, and it is magnificent in God's eyes. It is a quintessentially free creature. So another quality about life in the wild is freedom and fearlessness. And that's the case of the ostrich. God praises the ostrich for its fearlessness, even before the horse and its rider, the hunter. It will stand its ground and lift its plumage and cry out, not out of fear, but out of courage. And that's praised by God. And there's the vulture, which is praised for cleaning up the battlefields. The vulture is nature's natural vacuum cleaner. And that's given its due in God's answer to Job as well. And then there are the mythological creatures of behemoth and leviathan. And this is what God says about behemoth. And it's the only time that God talks about the wild in relationship to Job. Just in one little footnote. Behold, behemoth, which I created with you. It is the first of the great acts of God. The mountains yield food for it, for all the wild animals play. Even if the river is turbulent, it is not frightened. It is confident, though Jordan rushes against its mouth. God affirms there's a bond between Job and this very strange creature. Some scholars have suggested that Behemoth is patterned off of the hippopotamus. So if that helps in your image of Behemoth, go with it. But what's the link between Job and Behemoth? It's left as an open question. But I think what God is saying is that Job, even though these creatures are so different from you and they lie beyond your imagination, you are connected to them, even though you may not realize it. And so Job's connection with Behemoth is Job's connection with the wild, by extension. And then there's Leviathan. Here's a good Bible trivia question. What animal in the Bible is a whole chapter of the Bible devoted to? Leviathan. Painfully detailed in chapter 41. No one is so fierce as to dare destroy it. Who can stand before it? Who can strip off its outer garment? Who can penetrate its double coat of mail? Who can open the doors of its face? There is terror all around its teeth. On earth it has no equal. It is a creature without fear. It surveys everything that is lofty. It is king over all that are proud. Leviathan is one of those great sea monsters referred to in Genesis 1. And Leviathan is declared good. Even this monster of chaos has a role, a place in God's created order. And one thing is that it inspires humility for us. Thus endeth the words of God. And what happens after that, God, Job, remains on his ash heap. And then in the epilogue, God declares Job to be in the right and that his friends are declared guilty. But that's the prose narrative now, once again, unfolding. And Job is left back where he belonged, where he remained on his ash heap. But he's a different person. So I want to explore, these are his final words. Again, captivated by wonder, and then with a sense of being comforted over dust and ashes. So as God gives Job this sort of terrorizing, wondrous journey into creation, when Job returns, he's feeling comforted. That's very counterintuitive, but for him, wonder and comfort fit hand in glove. And so he's left with comfort. And it is no coincidence that those who remain with him, excluding his friends, could now begin to comfort him. He's able to accept the comfort of his community as they gather around him and eat with him and provide material assistance for Job before he is fully restored. So it's been a journey of wonder. And I want to kind of reimagine God's answer to Job by using creatures of this planet that remain untamable and perhaps shocking. I mean, more so than the lions that we put in zoos and the ostriches that we cage and eat, and wild asses. The auroch, by the way, is extinct now. So what are some creatures from our planet that seem so otherworldly that they could exist, they could be on another planet? So I'm going to reimagine Job for you, and I'm going to play the role of God as humbly as I can. So sit back and enjoy, and think how this experience ends up provoking a sense of awe and comfort, as it did for Job. Behold, Job, the dark, watery depths, where my creatures, great and small, flourish in freedom. You call it chaos and death, I call it the womb of life. Behold, Jove, the bottom of the deep dark sea, where countless life forms oblivious to the sun flourish under great pressure and in superheated water. Among them are my delicate tube worms that extend up to 10 feet in length amid large colonies of bacteria. Humans classify these creatures as extremophiles, because they live in conditions that humans themselves cannot withstand. But life began when Earth was ruled by extreme conditions. This wasn't Darwin's warm little pond. And you, Jove, are just a mere mesophile. Jove, behold the enigmatic Grimpotithus. This is no anime cartoon character. Humans call it the Dumbo octopus that simply rests in the bottom, on the bottom with its mantle spread around it. And Jove, do you know what it does there sitting so still in the dark? All right then, I'll let you in on a secret. It's meditating on Torah. And this little squid of mine, I'm going to let it shine. My jewel squid has the most sophisticated lighting system of any creature of the deep, complete with filters, reflectors, and eyelids, all of which allow it to regulate the duration and intensity of its luminosity. And it can even vanish into the darkness if it so chooses. And Jove, I'm sorry, but all you've got are fragile receptors with blind spots. Ah, yes, the Pacific viper fish with his long long and pointy fangs that leave little chance of escape for its prey. And yet its teeth are so prominent that it has to put up with them, put up carrying them outside its mouth, dangerously close to its eyes. And if it miscalculates the size of its prey and impales an animal that is too big, it may find itself unable to swallow it or to spit it out, condemned therefore to die along with its last supper. But Job, my favorite creature of the deep, is the one that humans disparagingly call Vampiratophus infernalis. Too bad you don't know Latin, Job, for it means the vampire squid from hell. It was so named because it frightened the living daylights of its first discoverers. But it is my mascot of the deep. Half squid, half octopus, dating back to 200 million years ago. And this creature can do something that no other creature can. It can dwell quite happily in the oxygen-depleted layer of the ocean. And it can do so by a special respiratory blood pigment. And being the slowest cephalopod of the sea helps as well. But Job, let's go back in time, say 375 million years ago, a mere twinkle of my eye. Let's go back in time to another creature that humans call Tiktaalik rosae. It was recently discovered in the river sediments in the Arctic Circle, and humans have nicknamed it Fishapod, for it provides the missing link between fish and tetrapod. I have a better name for it. I simply call it snout. Its story has been told by one of my favorite writers, Lauren Isley, next to Moses, of course. Snout's story begins, as such things always begin, in the ooze of unnoticed swamps and the darkness of eclipsed moons. And it begins with a strangled gasping for air. On the oily surface of the pond, from time to time, the snout thrust upward. It took in air with a queer grunting inspiration, and then it swirled back to the bottom. The pond was doomed, the water was foul, and the oxygen almost gone. But the creature would not die. It could breathe air directly through a little accessory lung, and it could walk. In all that weird and lifeless landscape, it was the only thing that could. It walked rarely and under protest, but that was not surprising, for this creature was a fish. And in the passage of days, the pond became a puddle, but the snout survived. And there was dew one dark night and a coolness in the empty stream bed. And when the sun rose the next morning, the pond was an empty place of cracked mud. But the snout did not lie there. It had gone. Downstream, there were other ponds. It was an uncanny business if there had been anyone there to see. It was a journey best not observed in daylight. It was something that needed swamps and shadows and the touch of the night dew. It was a monstrous penetration of a forbidden element, air, and the snout kept its face from the light. Behold the snout, Job. Even when the pond evaporates, it is not alarmed. Remains confident that they can breathe above the surface of the waters. do not mock its face, Job, for in 375 million years, that face would be your own. So, Job, come back to the surface and gird up your loins. Take a deep breath, and for every breath you take is shared by all air-breathing life on Earth. Breathe, Job. Take in the breath of life and live anew, knowing that you have found kinship with the children of the wild, and equally so with the children of Adam. So Job, having beheld the beasts of the sea and the creatures of the primordial past, emerged slowly out of the watery depths. And he took a breath, full and deep, as if for the first time. And Job crawled back onto his ash heap, where he had suffered the insults of his friends, and had once charged God with wrongdoing, bitterly awaiting his death. But now, amid the shocked silence of his friends, Job slowly lifted himself up, standing erect on his ash heap. And he prayed. He prayed not for himself, but for his friends who had betrayed him. And then Job walked back home, ready to begin his new life. Such was the journey of Job, in the book of Job, in God's revelation of creation. You might say that this was Job's baptism into nature. And he comes back home, where he is restored with the same number of children and double his possessions. Sounds like a return to the old life of Job, but it isn't, because he's changed. But you have to read between the lines to see that change in the epilogue. So in that last chapter of the book, chapter 42, we find Job doing something radically different. He's no longer the supreme patriarch of his family, in which everything depended on him. He gives a share of his inheritance to his three daughters, which is unheard of in ancient patriarchal practice. The inheritance always goes to the sons, and it is the daughters who have to fend for themselves to marry outside of the family. But through Job, his daughters become agents of independence for themselves. They now have the material wherewithal to lead their lives however they see fit. So Job is breaking patriarchal practice because he has been transformed by what he has seen from the voice of the whirlwind, which has shown him the wonders of creation. Shocking, terrorizing, wondrous, and ultimately comforting. What is the source of Job's comfort in all this? That's a question for you to imagine and for me to imagine. I imagine a Job who is kind of acting wildly now, out of care and love and compassion for others whom he had written off as objects of pity or simply as othered by him as a patriarch. God has opened his eyes. May God open your eyes and my eyes as we move forward in this life together. Of vitality for the church, of vitality for the world. So much seems to be stacked against us, and the odds are against us at such a time as this. Job ends up being a radical, a revolutionary within his own context. And it took a world to be shown to him for the world is breathing vitality in ways he could never imagine. And now he appropriates that within his own life. And I pray and hope you do the same as we move forward together. Thank you for this journey of wonder, and I may see you tomorrow as well.